slide.
Hello everyone, I'm Ron Ross, and there's Matt Hartman. We're going to tag team this today, so we'll switch halfway through. We work for the University of Cincinnati, and we're currently working on a large React project. So I heard a lot of Angular, heard a little bit of Ember, so I think we're the smaller sliver on the pie chart. So hopefully we can get you excited about React. But we specifically want to talk about Webpack and how that's really helped us in our front-end development. So Webpack describes itself as a module bundler. So what does that exactly mean? For those that have used Browserify, you know about creating bundles and exporting those out. Well, Webpack kind of does the same thing. It allows us to use the common JS, or you can use AMD, or you can use ES6 imports, and it'll crawl through your dependencies and package everything up for you. So you don't have to explicitly call those out and how those are chunked and exported. So it's really nice how it looks at those requires, bundles them together. So we can see, can everybody see this? All right. So at the top, using CommonJS, we're able to define our React dependency. And we could also pull in our React components, where they're at. You could even do this with images, and if you're using Less or Sass, you can include those, and it will package those up for you. So any type of dependency you're using, it's really nice. It also does code splitting. So for us, we're developing on top of a big ERP system. So we have to plug pieces here and there, and we're using the ERP system to present that to the web for us. And we're able to split our code into different bundles that if one page renders and it doesn't need these resources, it's not cluttering up memory and pulling those in. And here's an example of just one entry point. And you could even split things out, like you could have your app code, and then you can split out your third-party vendors and put those in a separate dependency. And you could even say exclude like React, because we're going to load it from a CDN, but you can still use it in development and it'll pull those resources until you package it for production. And then you could see we're just pulling in, we have really two entry points. It's going to output a bundle JS, and you can see how it can chunk your vendor bundle, and then you could have your local bundle. And chunking is really nice because it'll divide those up and it'll divide them up into different files, and it will handle loading those in for you. So it's really nice. Loaders are a great feature of Webpack as well, because we were able to get off using grunt or gulp, because this does a lot of our transforms and minifies and uglifies for us. So you can see here where we're using Less, and we can pull in the Less loader. And if you've used gulp before, you can pipe things together. So you can do the same thing here with the bang right there. So we're doing the Less loader, then we're piping that into the CSS loader, which will minify all our CSS, concatenate it, and everything like that. So it's really nice how you can chain those. Here we're using 6 to 5 because we're trying to write ES6 code. And you could add exclude so it doesn't go through your node module, which I found out the hard way. And then you could even do any transforms you need on your images for your site. So if you have to support Retina. And then the docs, we have a link to the docs out there. Now that is one of the criticisms of Webpack. Their documentation is a little bit tough to get through, but there's a lot of external documentation, a lot of blog posts that really help you. We didn't have that big of a problem, but if you really want to support the project, docs is where they need some help. It also features a really nice plugin system. So we're using a plugin system here, so we can say, all right, when we're in dev, We can pull in certain features. When we actually build for production, you can use Webpack, you know, -P, and that way we don't pull in a lot of these features, and we can select what features are actually put into production. So. But wait, there's more. Does anybody have any questions so far? I went through that kind of fast. Oh, we have a bottleneck. Uh-oh.
Yeah, and another thing with the, I go back. So one thing we're doing here is we're looking at using this for like feature flags. And when you run Webpack -P, that's Webpack production, it'll actually remove anything that's dead code. So anything you have in a feature flag that's not turned on, it just strips that out of the JavaScript. That way people that are viewing source won't see it. Kind of a nice feature. We're going to take advantage of that for sure. We also use it so we don't have to hard code any usernames, passwords, URLs, that kind of stuff. So we can build it for the environment. Okay. So a couple more tools that are related to Webpack. One thing that's really nice is the Webpack dev server. So that's a separate install. It's just an NPM. But that gives you a nice little express server that does live reload. So as you're changing your JavaScript, it'll detect that, rebundle your code, and refresh your browser. So it's just a nice development tool. And then the other thing that we've just started looking at, and I'm going to give a quick demo, is hot module replacement. So what that does is, if your application's set up right, if you change, so you saw he required the grades.jsx, if that changes, Webpack will actually rebuild it, talk to the browser, and just swap out that JavaScript. And I'll show you how that works. So your browser doesn't actually reload, just the JavaScript inside reloads. And because we're using React, that state, it just re-renders and that state's there. So it's really a neat feature, especially for development.
Is that because you have immutable data structure?
We are using immutable, but it's really leveraging React's virtual DOM. So React's like reconciling.
And also, we'll share this slide because this little doc by Pete Hunt, who used to work for Instagram, one of the contributors for React, that's kind of what turned us on to React, was seeing a presentation from him on how Instagram works. So that's a good YouTube presentation to watch. Go back to that. Okay. So what I did here is I've got a Safari and a Chrome browser open. So just to kind of show you how this looks. This is the hot reload, hot modules. So I'm in here, if you can see, this is the comment box component in React. So all I'm going to do is I've got Webpack running. And I just wanted to show you how the hot reload works. So I'm changing the JSX here. And we don't have to get into how JSX works in React. We want to talk about that later. But if you've got questions after, or even a little bit now, we can do that. But I'm just going to change this code. This is all JavaScript, even though it looks like HTML. Webpack will actually take that JSX and transpile it to JavaScript. So all I need to do is just hit save here. And it hot swaps that the JavaScript in the client side. And I don't have to do it. So I'm going to highlight comments so you can. I'll highlight another line so you can tell me that it's. So you can tell that my highlights stay there. That's kind of the test to see if you're really doing smoke and mirrors. It's really doing it's not reloading the page, it's just.
Yeah, so for you started adding assets in memory like this to-do list and then recycle that and you have to add that data back.
So. Right. So we could show quick. Is this my Chrome? And the console log kind of gives you let me clear that out and. So I don't know if you can see this, but it'll log out, the app updated, recompiling, checking for updates, and it actually pushes that module update to your browser. So we're going to use this for development just to make our experience a little nicer. I think people are looking into possible uses in production, but it's more of a development feature right now. Okay. And we're trying to start a new Slack channel called Cincy Tech. And so we'll send out the link, but if you want to click on that link, and I could do that now. We've actually made just a basic little form. So just walk through, put your name, your email address, what you do, kind of what your job is, or what your interests are. And we'll, I don't know, has everyone used Slack before? So it's kind of a thing people are starting are these private Slack channels. So we've got one we're trying to start, and the number of channels here, we're hoping it will grow as people that join are interested in, but this is where, we'd really like to help people understand Webpack and React, and we think this would be a good way to kind of have that conversation. Instead of individual emails, just have it here so everyone can participate.
But if you want us to add an Angular channel or an Ember channel, we could do that as well. Right.
Well, I gotta find my way.
You're gonna share the presentation.
Yeah, we'll share the presentation. Let's see.
I can post it on the meeting.
Okay. Yeah. I'll leave this here first.
So even though we're using Webpack to do our React development, like even if you're doing Angular, you should give it a try, especially if you're using Grunt or Gulp as well, and even Browserify. Just give it a try and see if it makes your life a little simpler. And how it chunks things, I don't want to get into comparing it with Browserify because there's a lot of friction right now on that. But if you are using that, how it chunks for us and it exports all those separate bundles just makes life easier for us, especially on that platform.
And part of that is then being able to load this JavaScript on demand in your single page app. So like if you went to a profile page, it would know, based on the request that it needs to go and grab that JavaScript. So you're not serving a 5 meg bundle of JavaScript all at once, which is one of the benefits. Okay. Questions?
Yeah, we are using immutable. I'll make up some questions. We are using immutable JS, so we can have some immutability in our data structures. It's really nice. So we just weren't ready to commit to closure and I just blanked on
ohm.
Yeah, and ohm. We weren't ready to commit to that, but we're very much doing the same thing. So we're using cursors to track when data changes. And passing that back up and cascading through all our components so they can communicate
that. That makes model loading a lot safer.
Yeah. And there is Flux, that's another, architecture for doing that, but it just seemed when we started to implement it, it was not as easy as using cursors and not as straightforward. Okay.
Cool. So maybe you can walk through in React. Can you go back to your source code?
Sure.
So what the project kind of looks like. So this is your samples. You have server.js, you have...
Right.
What's client? What is your client-side stuff that you're...
Yeah, the server.js is just... This just bootstraps and
expresses. But mainly on the server, yeah. You're doing the client
side.
See,
that's a good point. So Webpack... You can tell it to build different types of bundles. So for us, we build a web bundle, and
so for the client side,
it creates the closure. Yeah, but if you wanted to do more isomorphic applications, you can also render it out to a node module, and then if you're serving with like Express or whatever, you can just include that in React, render the string, and you have isomorphic.
Where do you actually go bootstrap it? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Okay.
But where you actually, like in the index.html, where you load.
Well, this is all client-side, so there we're just including the bundle. This is the bundle that you're out of your...
So the bundle is produced server-side.
Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
So it binds to that div.
So this is a single-page app. So a single-page app where you might have multiple... So we have an app where it has like X number of different modules, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you used to, I think I said it, migrating over to Flex, right? But Flex used to have module functionality you could download them asynchronously, call it lazy loading them. And there's, there's some kind of talk of doing that in the JavaScript world, lazy loading of modules, pulling down. Have you done anything with that, with this? Where in a larger single page app where you have, this probably, it looks like it pulls in you're pulling in a couple files into that, and maybe the style.
Yeah, this is a very simple.
But you can define, we're defining multiple, have you opened the Webpack config?
Yeah, sure.
So you can control a lot of your entry points. So you may have several entry points, or you may still have one entry point, but you want to say we need to split on these resources because they're only used like 20% of the time.
Right there.
So Webpack will generate these files for you, and they may look a little crazy. It'll be like a chunk.js, and it'll keep track of managing those resources as needed.
So when it does this, does it do all the source mapping as well? So how do I debug this live when I've now smashed all this together, uglified and minified?
Yeah. So we use the source maps in development, and what that is in your loader. Depending on what you're doing in your loader, you can say include source maps for development.
Okay. Yeah. So this is just a sample project. That's why I was.
Yeah.
For the hot reload.
That's okay.
Good question, so.
So you mentioned that some method earlier. It might be worth
it. Yeah, so isomorphic. Unfortunately, we can't take advantage of that on the platform we're doing, but we've done several tests just to make sure we could wrap our heads around it. And, quite simply, it's where you can render your JavaScript on the browser, on the server. So that way, when your page is actually rendered to the browser the very first time, you could have at least some limited functionality. And it's really nice with React, plugging React again, because React will load later in the client and reconcile on the DOM, and then all of a sudden your page is live. And a really good example of that is if you go to Airbnb, you see a static image, and then all of a sudden, a second later, the video starts loading. And if you actually disable JavaScript, you still get a functional page. It's just not as beautiful as what you would expect.
So the other idea behind that is it helps solve the SEO problem, right?
Yeah. And the screen reader problem.
Yeah.
So at the university, accessibility is a big issue.
What was it?
SEO. So search indexing.
And see what how it costs.
Yeah, we can't. We're on an ERP calling RESTful services, really, so we can't take advantage of that.
Did you said you were using Gulp or Grunt before?
Yeah, we were using Grunt, and we made the progression. This started out as going to be an Angular app, and then as we started hitting some of the issues with Angular and the directives and that, React came around, and we decided to give it a... But
what kind of issues did you have?
The directives were a little tough, and the directives, can you open a JSX file? Now this might start a war.
No, for
what it's worth. But having your template over here and how Angular worked with directives just seemed a little, it didn't seem as comfortable as just having everything handled inside of here. So we see something that looks like markup, that's JSX. So everything inside this, we have everything inside our module to render. So we're handling the events in here, we're handling how the markup will look, and that's being rendered out to the browser. So as many have said before, it's really how Angular handles the separation of duties in field writing, separating technology, templates, and having JavaScript. This actually separates concerns because we are concerned with how the template renders. And another nice thing of having your markup in there is when we write tests, we don't have to open the browser to test that. We can run it from the command line, React, and virtualize the DOM and say that, yes, you are, there is an H1 tag. It will render your test. And it makes testing a little easier. Did that answer your question?
No.
And we probably had the same problem that most people did. When we were doing Angular, our controllers just kept growing and growing, and then communicating between controllers just didn't seem as easy as communicating between React components.
And another one of our goals is we're actually developing the the student interface to this PeopleSoft, right? So this is like the student portal. But in that, there would be a lot of reusable components like, you know, your class schedule, grades, you know, things that we're hoping other universities will be interested in, too. And so doing React, it's just the React components are just small and isolated, and that makes it really easy for us to hopefully collaborate with other schools.
So if a school just wanted the grade schedule, but they didn't care about anything else, they could just pull that in and include that bundle. Well, yeah, that's...
I don't have an answer to that.
Yeah, not really yet. I know Ember's really kind of the first one to do that, but I think how React is handling building components, that could happen with little disruption to the developers. Except for us. But it can handle it with a little disruption. So.
Yes, it is, buddy.
Yeah, so you know, if you're into Slack, go ahead and join our community, and we'll make it more than our community, make it, you know, a Cincinnati community. So
that's awesome. Yeah, that's awesome. More curiosity on that. How are you guys getting? So we have a channel.
That's a good question.
Yeah. Okay.
That bill's gonna come.
Again. Yeah. So we should talk.
Yeah. We should. Yeah. Definitely. I just wanted to start the conversation. Yeah, no. I just wanted to start something, and then we can.
Yeah. It's great.
We'll figure out a way.
If you see someone pick it up, that's awesome.
Yeah. That's a good point. Maybe we should do IRC. All right.
Awesome.
I'm good.
Thanks.